Xin mời chương ông quý chủ. បន្តកិច្ចដំណើរការនីតិវិធីសំណាកាដេញដោលលើអ្នកជំនាញបណ្ឌិត Craig Etcheson ជាបន្តមុននឹងចាប់ផ្ដើមកម្មវិធីឡើងរាយការណ៍អំពីស្ថានភាពវត្តមាននិងអវត្តមានភាគីដែលត្រូវបានត្រូវចូលរួមនៅក្នុងដំណើរការសំណាកានេះ សូមគោរពលោកប្រធានភិក្ខុដែលបានចូលរួមនៅក្នុងដំណើរការនីតិវិធីសមនាការក្នុងថ្ងៃនេះមានវត្តមានគ្រប់ចំនួនចំណែកឯអ្នកជំនាញក៏មានវត្តមានក្នុងទទួលសមនាការផងដែរកាលពីម្សិលមិញដំណើរការនៃការពិភាក្សាដេញដោលនេះគឺដល់វេទិកានៃភិក្ខុដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋបវេនីមេធាវីតំណាងដើមម្ដងរំនីក្រមមួយហើយមេធាវីតំណាងដើមម្ដងគុណមួយគឺ ភិក្ខុខាងមេធាវីភិក្ខុខ្មែរគឺបានធ្វើរួចហើយប៉ុន្តែនៅមេធាវីខាងអន្តរជាតិតំណាងឲ្យដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋបាលនីក្រមមួយដែលមានការប៉ុនប៉ងក្នុងការតាំងសំណួរពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងអ្នកជំនាញបណ្ឌិត
Thank you, Mr. President. Morning. Mr. Etcheson, let me just tell you before I start that on behalf of my team that we are very grateful for your patience and we are very grateful that you accepted to come, and not only on behalf of the attorneys present of my team but my whole team is working very hard. I wanted to tell you that. Let me start with some questions on torture. The accused last week on Monday 18th of May, and I'm going to read the exact quote from the transcript, seemed to suggest, answering a question from Judge Lavergne, that the notion of smashing included more than just killing. And let me read what he said. And it's transcript in English, 18 of May 2009, it was last Monday, page 14, and he said that. He said, now I would like to add further on top of what I told you already when it comes to smash, which means I arrest secretly, and then people who were arrested be interrogated with torture employed, and then they were executed secretly without the knowledge of their family members. So my question to you is this: would you agree that the term smash, as used by in the DK period, didn't mean only killing but more than that, or do you think that it meant only killing?
Thank you, counsel. I am certainly no Khmer language linguist, but my understanding is that the Khmer word we translate in this court as smash,
kamtek,
means a little bit more than just killing. Frequently, you will see this word translated not merely as smash, but rather as smash to bits. as in to smash into little pieces. It seems that this process was often a lengthy one and did involve more than the mere execution with a blow to the back of the skull or whatever method was used to murder. It involved not merely a physical smashing, but also a psychological smashing, and the regime of prisoner treatment inside S-21 was ideally suited to this sort of dehumanization and debasement of the individual psyche. So I would say, in short, yes, smash means something more than merely kill.
Thank you. So you may have answered my second question, but just for me to be completely clear, we are trying to understand if there was, you talked about at length policy and documents on smashing, and we are trying to understand if there was such an express policy on torture. Hence my first question. Now, in your research, did you come across any detailed order or directive issued by the Standing Committee on Torture, or do you consider that because they used the word smashing, then it was de facto covering torture? Is my question clear?
Yes, counsel.
Your question is clear. I have never seen an order or a directive from the Standing Committee explicitly ordering torture. But nonetheless, it is clear from various party publications and various pronouncements by the top leadership that they wished great ill on anyone defined as an enemy.
Now, to carry on this question, the accused in front of the investigating judge on the 2nd of October 2007, page 6, in English, the reference is D/20, said that there were four types of torture used, and he said, at least in the English version, they were authorized. So I believe you answered this question, but just for me to be completely clear, did you ever come across any document or anything which could lead you to believe that indeed this means of torture were authorized? And if so, by whom?
Thank you for the question. Counsel, I have not seen any documents originating from the senior leadership at the Standing Committee level which authorized particular forms of torture. However, there are numerous documents that we refer to as cadre notebooks,
which we
believe to have been written by staff members of S21, and which appear to record the substance of training sessions within S21, and which discuss various torture techniques.
And
based on your research, do you have any view on who devised these torture techniques?
That's an interesting question, counsel. And it's one that we have puzzled over at some length. It appears to me that most of the torture techniques were developed through practice or through learning from the Vietnamese Communist Revolution
and then
handed down among security officials and senior Khmer Rouge political officials in a sort of oral tradition. At the same time, if we are to believe the testimony of various former staff members at S21 and a few surviving prisoners from
S21,
quite a broad array of torture techniques were employed there.
Some of which,
seems as if they may be products of the inventiveness of the staff themselves.
And just to be clear, which staff are you talking about?
Look at
Etcheson. I refer in this instance to the interrogators at S21.
And according to you, who, if anyone, taught these interrogators this technique, if anyone?
I believe that was the principal trainer in torture techniques at S21.
And just to be clear, on what do you base your
belief?
I base this belief on statements by the accused person, statements from former S21 staff members and from surviving documents that were recovered at S21.
Thank you. Now, it was not clear to me, talking about torture, if there is any use of torture in the zone sector district throughout Cambodia. Now, paragraph 64 of your report, you said this, sector level security personnel also had the authority to torture prisoners. Now, what you just said to cut matters short, what you just said about S21, does it apply as well to the security centers outside Phnom Penh?
It is clear to me, counsel, that torture was widely practiced at security offices all around Democratic Cambodia, although most places appear to use a much smaller range of techniques.
So and that was exactly my next question. Based on your research, do you think there was a difference between the torture as practiced in security center throughout Cambodia and what happened at this 21 or not?
That's a difficult question, counsel. In terms of the pain and terror inflicted on the victims of torture, there may not have been a great deal of difference between the torture practice at S21 and the torture practice at other security offices. However, in the range of techniques, it seems to me that there was a difference.
Are you able to elaborate a little bit on that point?
Yes, counsel. At zone level security offices and at security offices situated in lower echelons, the range of torture techniques, by and large, although not universally, seem to be restricted to beatings, whippings, suffocation with plastic bags, and electrocution. In contrast, S21 appears to have used a wide variety of additional torture techniques, such as burning, piercing of fingernails and toenails, ripping out fingernails and toenails, flaying skin and then pouring salt or salty water on the wounds, tormenting with poisonous insects, various kinds of water tortures, tying hands behind the back, and then lifting the victim by the hands so as to cause dislocated shoulders, and a wide variety of other torments.
Thank you. That answers my questions on torture. I have for you some questions on confessions, and I do bear in mind the ruling which was made, and I'm not going to ask you any questions about the content of some confessions, but I'm interested in trying to understand more.
I do apologize for interrupting, Mr. President. Mr. Werner referred to a ruling that the court made on this evidence. To the understanding of the co-prosecutors, there has not been a ruling on this. And I just wanted to confirm that understanding with the President and the other judges.
Thank you, Mr. President. As the President has said, the Chamber has considered this matter and wishes now to give a clarification of the indication given a few days ago. The Chamber wishes to emphasize the importance of the fact that this Court is bound by the provisions of Article 15 of the Torture Convention, which the President has just read out. This provision is reflected in Article 38 of the Cambodian Constitution and also in Rule 21.3 of the Internal Rules, which states, no form of inducement, physical coercion or threats thereof, whether directed against the interviewee or others, may be used in any interview. If such inducements, coercion or threats are used, the statements recorded shall not be admissible as evidence before the chambers. In practice, this means that the fact that a confession has been made and that it was made under torture is an admissible fact. However, the contents of a confession made under torture cannot be accepted as a truthful statement. If any party wishes to refer to the truthfulness or otherwise of the contents of a confession, it will be necessary first to establish if the confession was made under torture or the threat of torture. For that reason, parties should consider whether an examination of the contents of a confession is sufficiently important to seek an inquiry concerning the circumstances under which the confession was made. And I just reiterate what the President has indicated. This is made to assist the parties and as a clarification of the earlier iteration of Article 15 of the Torture Convention. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you all for those clarifications. We have one further observation, just so that we understand clearly the import of what has just been said by Your Honours. There has been no ruling on the general principle. If I understand the comments correctly, it will be only when and if a party seeks to rely on the content of confessions that this question should be ventilated in full. If that is my understanding, then the co-prosecutors will say no more about it. But the co-prosecutors would seek to remind the chamber that this is an issue that is currently being briefed before the co-investigating judges in case file 2. It is an extremely complicated and sensitive issue. And if there were to be discussions of the general principle in this chamber, the co-prosecutors would request that similarly full submissions could be made in writing, given the sensitivity of these issues. If that is appropriate and meets with the approval of the court, that is what the co-prosecutors would propose, on the understanding that there has been no general ruling at present.
Thank you, Mr. President. It was for precisely that reason, namely that this matter is currently before the co-investigating judges relation to case 2, that no ruling has been given. But it is apparent that we are reaching a stage in this trial where it is necessary for a clarification to be given for the benefit of the parties, so that on a case-by-case basis, should the need arise, the parties can consider how important it is to refer to the contents of a confession, because it seems to the trial chamber that that will require, on a case-by-case basis, an examination of the circumstances under which that confession has been made. The trial chamber notes your submission that full submissions on the general topic may be needed at a later stage and certainly reserves that right to the parties. I hope that assists.
Yes, it does. Great.
Thank you,
Honour.
Thank you, Mr. President. I do apologize then for the slippiness of my language. Mr. Etcheson, the same way I think you very usefully helped us this chamber about torture, I'm trying to understand the same thing about confessions. In other words, if there were an expressed policy on confession, and if so, what would be the extent of that policy? Just to help you about a few things which are to give you some context about a few things which were said. Before you started testifying last Monday, on the 18th of May 2009, the agreed fact were read out and the accused was given an opportunity to comment on this agreed fact. And he said this on the agreed fact at paragraph 99, and for my learned friend, the draft transcript of last Monday, 18th of May in English, page 49 and 50, I'm going to read in full what he said. So the agreed fact was as follows. Dutch was often given instructions concerning the extraction and content of specific confessions, including references to CIA and KGB agents. And then, paragraph 44 of the closing order, the accused agreed, but he said it should be noted that the co-prosecutors have summarized paragraph 44 of the closing order, and the paragraph 44 of the closing order said that Dutch stated that in many cases he was given instructions concerning the extraction and content of specific confessions. In particular, he asserted that at the instigation of his superiors, the words CIA and KGB were initially used by the interrogators themselves. So here is my question. As far as you know, based on your research, would you say that there were written policy or rules about how to extract confession, or do you think that there were only oral instructions from superiors to the accused? Is my question clear?
Yes, counsel. That's clear. I would have to say that there were both oral instructions regarding the extraction of confessions and written instructions as well. Most of the written instructions of which we are aware were internal to S21 rather than consisting of specific directives from higher authorities. it also is apparent that the practice of torture at S21 and indeed from earlier at M13 evolved over time in conjunction with the methodology of extracting particular confessions.
And when you said that there was written instruction internal at S21, do you understand correctly that to the accused deciding on this internal instruction? Do I understand that correctly?
Yes, counsel. That's correct.
And what about the oral instruction then? What do you know about the oral instruction on how to extract confessions?
The accused person has spoken at some length in his interviews with the co-investigating judges of having received specific oral instructions regarding both methods of extracting confessions and the content of the desired confessions. There is also evidence on the case file of the accused person in turn transmitting oral instructions to his own interrogation staff regarding, again, both the form of conducting interrogations and the content of the desired
interrogation.
Thank you. Now, the same way I did for torture, I'm trying to understand if these confessions were unique at S21, or did that exist as well in the at local level? So here's my question. As far as you know, were detailed confession obtained as well at the zone sector and district levels, the same way they were at S21 or not?
Yes, counsel.
Look at Jason.
Confessions were obtained at security offices situated at other echelons than the center, that is, at zone, sector, and district echelons. In some instances, of which we are aware, these confessions extracted at lower echelon security offices were fairly elaborate, detailed, and lengthy. We have few surviving written records of this activity, a small number from here and there. Otherwise, we rely largely on testimony of perpetrators, bystanders, and a few survivors for our understanding of operations inside the zone, sector, and district echelon security offices. But based on the totality of this evidence, it's clear to me that the interrogation and confession producing process at S21 was far more elaborate. And rigorous than at any other security office of which I am aware.
Can you elaborate a little bit on
why it was more elaborate? Elaborate
that decision why? Yes, counsel. Look at Jason. Ban. Yum, I did not ban.
One reason. Confessions were more elaborate. That S21 had to do with the nature of the personnel who were being interrogated. Many of these personnel were veteran revolutionaries who had served the revolutionary cause for many decades, who had achieved a high rank in the revolutionary organization, who were personally acquainted with many other individuals of significant rank in the revolutionary organization,
or
who had personally recruited many individuals into the revolution, and thus, naturally, such individuals had many more topics which they could discuss in a confession and which might be of interest to those who were demanding that these confessions be produced. Consequently, there are some confessions in the S21 archive which were extracted over a period of many months and are very long, some in excess of 1,000 pages. There is nothing comparable of which I am aware at any other security office.
Thank you for this answer.
Are you aware of any annotations?
Excusez-moi. Nous avons eu dans la version française un problème de traduction il semblait que vous parliez quand vous avez dit une des raisons est liée à la nature des personnes, et on nous a traduit, et des interrogateurs, alors que semble-t-il, vous aviez dit, ça nous a été corrigé ensuite, à la nature des prisonniers. Est-ce que c'est bien de ça dont nous parle, dont vous avez parlé, à la nature des prisonniers? Et vous avez développé sur les prisonniers qui étaient des vétérans de la cause révolutionnaire, vous parliez bien des prisonniers à ce moment-là? Juste une explication, pardon.
C'est ça? Okay.
Donc il faut corriger dans la version française, il s'agissait bien des prisonniers qui étaient des vétérans de la cause révolutionnaire qui occupaient un rang élevé de la cause révolutionnaire. C'est bien ça, monsieur l'expert.
Merci.
Merci, mon confrère. I'm
grateful for this remark because I'm listening in English. Although quite a few people told me that I should ask my question in French. But so I cannot help for the French translation. So I'm grateful.
Just
to come back, so my question was, based on your research, are you aware of any annotation, the same way it was done at S21, and I'm going to come back on that topic to ask you a few questions about that, but just finish with the local level. Are you aware of any annotation on the confessions at local levels?
Yes, counsel, I
am.
And what can you say about these annotations?
Counsel, I can say that they exist.
That
this practice occurred at lower echelon security offices,
and that
the annotations were not as elaborate as or detailed as those we are familiar with in the context of the S21 documents. However, I'm afraid I cannot say much more about that because the documents in question are currently the subject of a judicial investigation.
To talk about the confessions at S21, you said yesterday and the day before, unfortunately we do not have any transcripts, so I cannot quote from a transcript, but I hope that I will faithfully quote you, and if not, please tell me. Yesterday and the day before, talking about what happened at S21, you spoke about the accused studying confessions, and then you spoke several times about list of proposed enemies, and you said as well, you used the word looking for enemies, and I was a bit confused. When you spoke about list of proposed enemies, did you talk about the annotation and the confessions, or is it for you something else?
Etcheson.
It is multiple things.
In the process
of extracting confessions, victims at S21 were routinely required to produce lists of names of persons who had supposedly conspired with them in the alleged treasonous behavior. So this is one type of list of names, one produced by the person being interrogated. In the archives of S21, we also find lists of proposed traitors, which appear to have been created by the interrogators or other S21 staff members in a process of analyzing the confessions that have been produced by the victim. So this is another type of list produced by staff rather than the victim.
Now, what is your understanding if anyone who ordered this list of enemies written by people who were being interrogated and list of traitors written by the staff members, if I followed you correctly? Do you know anything about who, if anyone, ordered such list to be written?
Etcheson.
Counsel, I can't immediately recall ever having seen an order per se to produce such lists other than an order directed at a specific prisoner. My understanding was that this was a practice developed to find himself, and that the accused person's superiors found this practice so helpful that this was one reason he eventually was promoted to be the chief of S21.
And just to be clear,
you said that your understanding is that this practice of this list were devised by the accused person. What is your basis for saying that
in both terms? Look, Etcheson.
This assertion is an analytical conclusion of mine based on all that I know about these processes inside the Communist Party of Cambodia.
Thank you. Now, just to finish, the last question on this list, just to give us an understanding on these two categories of lists, as far as you know, how many lists are we talking about? In broad terms, are we talking about 100,000, 10 for each category, as far as you know?
I have never counted them, counsel, but I would say possibly thousands.
For each category?
Yes. Thank
you. Now, I just have one or two questions on the annotations, which, if I understand you correctly, is something different than the list. Am I correct?
Yes, counsel, that's correct.
Now, first, let me ask you this. At the time Nat was chairman of ST21, do you know if Nat annotated confessions the same way the accused annotated confession later when he became chairman of
S21?
Counsel, I cannot recall having ever seen an annotation on a confession that was specifically attributed to Nat. It may be that there are some, but I do not believe there are a great number of such annotations.
Now, about the annotations, I'm just trying to understand how this annotation, the system of annotation, started. Are you aware of any order, either written or oral order, to start annotating this confession?
No, counsel. I am not.
And based on your knowledge then, and your research, how did this system of annotation, how did it start, or why did it start?
My surmise on that question, counsel, is that it was a product of the accused person's personal work
methods.
By profession, the accused person was a school teacher, and thus he was accustomed to marking up the papers of his pupils. My surmise is that he carried this practice over into his new profession as an interrogator.
And you alluded to that before when I was asking you about the annotations at the local level. Shortly, can you say anything about what you think the general way the accused annotated his confessions? What could you say about, in general terms, about these annotations?
Luke Etcheson.
There were a variety of different types of annotations. Some annotations appear to have a function similar to a routing slip, which would describe to whom a confession has been distributed and when. Some annotations appear to function as a memory aid by the accused person. For example, one that might say, already read,
or
not finished, or something of that nature. Other annotations would be instructions to interrogators of various types. The instruction might be that the accused person had decided the particular interrogation was complete, or it might instruct the interrogator to seek a particular type of information, or it might instruct the interrogator to apply torture. Other types of annotations are more analytical in nature. That is to say, many confessions contain a type of report summarizing the confession and analyzing the confession. Other types of annotations discuss broader aspects of an investigation that was underway by S21 and include matters that go beyond the boundaries of the contents of a particular confession. Still, other annotations appear to be notes made by superiors, such as Son Sen or Nguyen
Chia.
Thus, it is difficult to generalize about annotations, because there are many different kinds.
Thank you for your answer. I have some questions now about the intervention and this confession, not by people who wrote the confession themselves, the detainees, but by other people.
Now,
The accused person said in front of the instructing judge on the 29th of November 2007, page 15, in the English version, document is D/30, that Sun Sen spoke on the phone every day with him about the confession, and then he had, and I quote, successive corrections to make. Now, bearing in mind what you said yesterday about the fact that you believe that Sun Sen was a very busy man, based on your research and understanding, do you think it's correct to say that Sun Sen intervened and had successive corrections to make on the confessions and the content of the confessions?
counsel.
I believe that
this assertion by the accused person is entirely plausible in the case of the interrogation of particularly senior members of the Communist Party of Cambodia. For many of the ordinary soldiers and other cadre who became victims of S-21, that seems much less plausible.
Now,
in court last week, again, just before you took the stand on Monday, the 18th of May 2009, and that can be found in the transcript, the draft transcript in English, page 52-54, the accused said himself that people were intervening on the confession, basically changing the confession with a pen, changing the confession. And I'm going to quote exactly what he said. He said this: some other people were implicated, but the standing committee did not take action. For example, Tamok, his name was mentioned in the confession, but he was not arrested. Having heard of Tamok, the standing committee reminded Aydin and did not take any action. And Brother Khoi's name of Son Sen, his name was also implicated in several confessions, but the standing committee did not take action. So this is just examples. I still remember how the confessions were sharpened. So I would like to give you an example of how the confessions were framed. Because when they wanted to arrest anyone, then they would like confession to be aimed into that direction. So, first of all, let me ask you this. Do you agree with that statement by the accused, that basically people were, I guess, changing the content of the confession? Do you agree with that statement, based on your research?
Yes, counsel.
Look, Etcheson,
I believe there is evidence beyond the statements of the accused that this practice did occur in some instances.
And as far as you know, who sharpened these confessions and the examples you are talking about?
At this remove, counsel,
Etcheson,
it is difficult to conclusively prove that, but it would seem that the senior leaders of the revolution, Son Sen, Nguyen Chea,
Nguyen Chea,
and possibly even
Pol Pot,
may have been responsible for such interventions.
And as far as you know, did the accused himself sharpen or frame any confessions in your knowledge?
No, counsel, I cannot think of an example of that.
Etcheson, could you not look with your heart that don't look at
now, the accused, in front of the instructing judge, on the 21st of January 2008, page 7 in the English version, the document is at D/38, talked about a stenotyped letter from Son Sen telling interrogator at S21 to be careful not to accept confessions which accused too many people.
Yes, counsel.
And I don't want to ask you any questions about the content, but I just want to know, as far as you know, was that the only instruction that you are aware of about instruction from someone at the operation to the staff at S21 on what to do and not to do with the confessions? Are you aware of other instances of interventions?
Ta ta thua yang mai rui ko man trau thua yang mai ta leu ka ta nei yang anu rui ko luk dang tha vi mien sik dai bong kwap baep ni phsei phsei tiet.
Yes, Council. I'm aware of other instances of interventions.
Can you elaborate on that? Can you elaborate on that? Can you elaborate on that? Can you elaborate on that?
On at least one occasion, Son Sen personally visited S21 to conduct training of the staff. Although we do not have clear notes or minutes from that training, it is easy to imagine such topics might well have arisen during that training session.
Now, you said here in court, I believe on Tuesday, that once the accused studied the confession, proposed purges, and then sent the proposal at upper echelon. When you said that he proposed purges, were you talking about this list that you mentioned before, or is it still something else?
That's correct, Counselor. The lists of people who had been identified as enemies.
Now, when you said that he sent this list at upper echelon until September 1977, is it correct to say that Son Sen was involved in this upper echelon when the lists were sent? Would that be correct?
Yes, it would be correct
to say that Son Sen was involved.
And then, just for us to understand, once Son Sen left Phnom Penh, what can you say, if anything, about his involvement with this list or whatever was sent from S21 coming from the confession? Do you know if Son Sen was still involved in any decision-making process after he left, if you know?
As the co-prosecutor observed yesterday, in reference to the set of notes from Division 502 Secretary Sumet to the accused person, some of those notes appear to have gone through Son Sen even after mid-August 1977. So yes, it would appear that Son Sen remained involved to some extent, at least, or in certain cases, after he departed for the battlefield.
Thank you for that. Now, in front of the instructing judge, on the 28th of February 2008, page 8 in the English version that can be found at code D/52, the accused said that in case of large arrest within the same unit, following a decision of the standing committee, he, the accused, asked her to talk with the person in charge of that unit in order to calm down the men of that unit. Are you aware of any document with such instructions?
No, Counsel, I'm not.
So I take it to mean that you cannot say if there was more than one instruction like this. You do not know about the existence of such an instruction. Am I correct?
You are correct, Counselor.
So I move on. I have one question, and then I will have finished with the topic of the confession. You were very, I think, clear and explicit in explaining the extent of the purge, and in particular in the Revolutionary Army of Kampuchea. And to quote you last Tuesday, and I have a transcript, you said there were widespread purges throughout the Revolutionary Army of Kampuchea, and then you said the same day at least 359 people were purged from the general staff itself, and then on your charts, and I'm happy to, I have them with me if you want me to show them to you, but I think you know them on the chart book, page 5, 45.7% of S21 prisoners were members of the Revolutionary Army of Kampuchea, and in your report, page 27, two vice chair of the Revolutionary Army of Kampuchea were purged, five secretaries of division were purged. So I think you were very clear and you went into great details to explain the widespread way in which the purges in the Revolutionary Army of Kampuchea. My question is this. Do you see any causal link between the fact that Sun Sen was at the same time the chairman of the general staff and the boss for the 2 years of the accused and involved, as you mentioned in this confession? Do you think there was any causal effect? Do you understand my question?
No, I'm afraid I do not, counsel.
You said that there were widespread purges in the Revolutionary Army of Kampuchea. Do you think that the fact that Sun Sen was at the same time chairman of the general staff and the boss of the accused for over a year, do you think that may have caused the fact that there were such widespread purges or not?
Thank you, counsel. I believe I understand your question, and the answer would be no. I believe the causes for the widespread purges in the Revolutionary Army of Kampuchea were not directly related to the fact that Sun Sen was both chief of the general staff and the direct supervisor of the accused person.
And just in a nutshell, if you can, why not?
Without delving into the content of any particular confession, I believe it was the contents of confessions extracted at S21, which persuaded the upper leadership that there was a conspiracy against them on the part of several military leaders.
I understand. You said yesterday that about the purge in the Ministry of Economy, one can say that it could have been caused by the paranoia of the Standing Committee, and one can say that it was caused by the, and again, I apologize, I do not have any transcript, but I think, just tell me if I'm misquoting you, he said that one can say that it was the system of systematically looking and identifying for enemies devised by the accused, and you said that you believe it was both. Now, would you accept the proposition that precisely this system of looking and identifying for enemies may have fed or strengthen the paranoia of the standing committee. Would you accept that proposition?
Yes, Council. It's a good example of what systems analysts call a positive feedback loop. The system feeds on itself and continually generates greater energy.
Thank you. I have one question about another policy of the CPK. Are you aware of any deliberate policy of starving prisoners?
Yes, Council.
And what can you say about this policy?
Based on my various research into these questions, I would say that starvation of prisoners in security offices appeared to be a very widespread, in fact, nearly universal policy throughout Democratic Kampuchea. And that indeed, in some instances, it appeared to be used as a low-impact method of execution.
What, if anything, can you say about the implementation of that policy at S21?
Based on various forms of testimony and evidence that I have seen, I would say that the diet provided to prisoners at S21 were starvation rations that would eventually cause the death of any prisoner subjected to them.
And am I correct to understand that that was an implementation of that policy?
It appears to be, Council.
Thank you. I have one question about, it is not clear to me, about the relationship between secretaries of zone and sectors on one hand and representative of general staff. You said on Monday, it's in the draft transcript, page 8586, and I'm quoting you, each zone committee commanded division and regiment-sized military units which were commanded and managed by a general staff based in each zone. Similarly, sector committees commanded armed units, often of regiment size, which were also generally managed by a general staff. And I was just wondering, because it was not clear to me, at the zone and sector levels, who had more power between the zone or sector secretary and the representative of the general staff, who, if I understand things correctly, was in charge of the armed force in that zone or sector? Do you understand my question?
Yes, Council. I believe I do understand your question, and it's a very interesting question, because problems of civil military relations and civilian control of military forces is a general problem throughout all governments of the world, and indeed, often particularly so in political systems that are based on extreme degrees of coercion. In general, a fundamental principle of the Communist Party of Cambodia, enunciated in a variety of their foundational documents, such as the CPK statutes, decisions of the Standing Committee, and so forth, state very clearly that it is the party which is to command military forces
in most instances.
This appears to have been the way it worked at the zone echelon and at the sector echelon. But the power of a military commander who is headstrong and confident is something that all political leaders must consider very carefully.
Thank
you. On Monday, and it appears in the draft transcript 18 of May, page 71, you said this: over the course of the regime, I believe Sun Sen was eventually promoted to full membership in the Standing Committee, while Kong Sopal remained an alternate member until his eventual arrest and execution
in S21.
Could you tell us, when do you think Sun Sen became a full member of the Standing Committee?
I believe Sun Sen became a full member of the Standing Committee no later than November 1978 and possibly somewhat earlier.
Now, the accused, both in front of the instructing judge and the reference for my learned friend is, said that on the 5th of September 2007, page 6D/16, but he said it as well in court on the 30th of April in the draft transcript, page 70-75. The accused said that, according to him, Sun Sen was number 7 of the regime. Do you agree with that proposal?
I
mean that statement, sorry.
Look, Etcheson,
over the course of the regime, the ranking of the top members evolved constantly as they jockeyed for power among themselves, and as the purges proceeded into the very upper ranks of the revolution. So these rankings did change over time, but it's entirely plausible that at one point Sun Sen did have the formal number 7.
But I'm interested in actual power. I think you explained very well to George Cartwright, and you went into great length to explain that he was very powerful because he was at the same time in the government, deputy prime minister in the army, chief of staff in the party, alternate member or member of the Standing Committee. So would it be correct that to say that not formally in a formal structure, but de facto in terms of actual power, would it be correct that he was more powerful than other full member of the Standing Committee like Rao's name, Sao Pim, or even Phom Vet? Would you agree with that?
That's a very difficult question, counsel. Power is an intangible thing and difficult to measure. Power can consist simply in one's persuasiveness in small group meetings and ability to influence the decision-making behavior of groups. certainly in terms of his ability to command military forces,
Sun Sen
was more powerful than Von Vet or
Ing Sari.
However, how much influence Sun Sen had in the policy making the deliberations of the standing committee might be another matter.
Thank you.
Could you just confirm, because you went with Josh Cartwright in this your chart of the standing committee in your report, and you explained the E and the D and the S, what that meant. Just to be clear on the record, for Gross Nim, you said he was executed, but I didn't find anywhere in the record, it's not clear how he was executed. Is it correct that he was put to Slang?
Yes, counsel, that's correct.
Your Honor, I know the time, I still have some questions, not too many. Some questions. Do you want me to carry on, or do you want to take a break?
Monsieur le Président, si je peux me permettre, est-ce qu'il est envisagé de laisser la parole à la défense à un moment? Je suis quand même un peu inquiet. Mon confrère, Maître Werner, avait annoncé hier 20 minutes de questions. Même en retranchant le quart d'heure qu'on a consacré à l'observation des coprocureurs, il y a maintenant une heure que Maître Werner pose des questions. Je sais que Maître Alex Beck doit me quitter ce soir. Je souhaiterais pouvoir poser mes questions à M. Craig Etcheson avant le départ de M. Bates et avant mon propre départ. Et j'aimerais que peut-être on se donne quelques limitations dans cette chambre quand on regarde le temps qui est réservé à la chambre, au procureur, puis au parti civil par rapport au temps qui est consacré à la défense. Alors j'aimerais que M. Werner soit invité à concentrer ses questions pour laisser du temps à la défense. Merci, M. le Président.
I would be happy to do so.
And apparently you seem, George Laverne seems to agree that I committed yesterday. If I did, then I didn't intend to do so. I was just trying to express the fact that I would be more than 20 minutes or half an hour. I knew I would be more. So if I did so, then it was by mistake. And I apologize for that.
ហើយលើដោយ DVD ថតទំលេងក៏អស់ផងហើយក៏ដល់ពេលទៅសម្រាប់ផងអង្គជំរះប្រកាសសម្រាប់ 20 នាទីរហូតដល់ម៉ោង 11 5 នាទីសូមអញ្ជើញចូលវិញដើម្បីបន្តដំណើរការពិភាក្សាដែលដល់តទៅទៀតប៉ុន្តែតុលាការត្រូវអនុរលដល់អ្នកជំនាញដើម្បីបានកន្លែងសម្រាប់សំរុំ